Hi there. This is the second part of my Neahkahnie Mountain tutorial, where I'm trying to create a scene based on a real-life place, suggested by Terry Bellows. And in this, the second part, I'm going to demonstrate how to create these trees. Now, although it's not obvious, there are actually two techniques being used here. We've got these trees here that are close to the camera and therefore need quite a lot of detail. And you can obviously see that light's reflecting off individual needles here. And then we've got a different kind of tree for all these thousands of trees that are actually a particle system. Now, if all of these had the same level of geometry as these few trees that are much closer, my computer at least would certainly struggle to render this. So in actual fact, there's a little cheat that I employ. I've used it in one or two other renders, and I'll show you how to do that. So first of all, we need to create our fir trees. So let's go to a new layer, and we're going to use the sapling add-on. If you never used that before, go to User Preferences, under Add-ons, type Sap for Sapling, and then make sure that the Add Curve Sapling is switched on. And by the way these are described tells you where you will find them. So in this case, it's saying Add Curve Sapling. So you will find the Sapling add-on under the Curve Add menu. So if we go to Add, and then come up to Curve, we can see we've got Add Tree. Unfortunately, the names don't always completely align, so you have to use a little bit of imagination sometimes. So in this case, it's the Add Tree. So we've got a basic tree here, and the first thing I'm going to do, although I'm moving the viewport around, I'm not moving this object around, because as soon as you do, the options for it will disappear from the left-hand side here. I'm going to turn on Bevel, which will make it a bit easier to see. So we want a fir tree, so we need to play around with some of the geometry a bit. It's not far off to begin with, but obviously fir trees leaves tend to start quite close to the ground. The ratio is obviously setting the ratio of the thickness of the trunk to the rest of the tree. And it needs to be reasonably thick, but that's perhaps a bit too much. So we'll go for 0.02. Random seed will just give us some variation on the settings. And I think that first one is actually not far off. In terms of the bevel resolution, at the moment the tree is essentially square. We're going to use these relatively close up, so we need a few more options on it than that. So I'm going to go for 2, which is a reasonably high resolution tree. Curve resolution is the resolution along here, and again, the default's a bit low, so I'm going to go for 6. Now we'll go for branch growth. I'm going to widen this window a little bit, and you can see each of these applies to a level, as in the trunk level, the first branch level, or if we've got more branches, the next branch level. So this top one applies to this first length here. So I'm going to reduce that, and you can see the trunk itself is reducing in length. So the next setting we go to is branch splitting. Each of these relates to a level, and you can see how many levels of splitting we've got here. So we've got 2, so that gives us the first level and the branches. If I take that down to 1, we've just got the trunk itself. So I'll just put that back up to 2 for the moment. Base splits is effectively it's the trunk itself splitting. So we don't particularly want that. That's not typical of a fir tree. And now you can see how base size affects it. So by reducing base size, this is making the branches start much lower down. And that's what we want for a fir tree, I would say. Obviously, as always, you should look at reference images. But for my purposes, I'm just going to go off memory. So the next one is branch splitting. And then we've got split angle, down angle, and rotate angle. So if we play with the down angle of the second level, which is the branches, you can see they come down, but they've still got that curve on them. And if we play with the rotate angle, you can see how that works. We'll go back to the default for the moment. The radius ratio is setting the thickness, if you like, of the branches. And next to each of these is variation. So this is when you create new versions of this tree with a different seed. These are the parts that will vary with the different seed, and how much they vary is set here. So it allows you to create a type of tree without completely tying down the exact shape of the tree so that they vary slightly with the different random seeds. So I'm going to make the down angle perhaps a little lower than that, and then we'll go up to branch growth, and you can see we've got curvature on here. So if we play with that, you can see I can straighten them out a little, and we can go to this kind of effect, but I think it should be a little more like that. And I'm just really straightening these branches a little bit at the moment. You notice I'm playing with the second level because that's where the branches are, and it's just a matter of playing around to get the sorts of shape that you think is about right. So let's go up to 3 levels now, and this third level, we don't need anything like as long as that. I'm just reducing the number there, but if we go to the growth, you can see we've got a relatively large length on that. So let's bring that in quite a bit. We want a little bit there, but not too much. This is where all of the pine needles will be. So back to splitting, and this time we can put the number of them up. So let's try 25, so half that of the branches. Maybe even less than that, go for 15. In a moment we can go up another level, but at the moment the shape of the tree isn't right. So if we come back down to geometry, and you notice the shape is now available. You have to have three levels before the shape is available. So let's try conical. And immediately that starts to look a little bit more like a fir tree. And we can now play around with the angles of the tree. So that's now beginning to look a lot better. And if need be, you can go to pruning. But I think that will do for our basic fir tree. And now we'll go to leaves. So for my purposes, I'm just going to use a basic leaf. You could use alpha textures if you want to have a real pine needle shape, but they're fairly simple shapes. I just used rectangular shapes, but let's go for something with a little bit more shape to it. So I'll turn leaves on, and obviously they're not quite right at the moment. This one is the overall scale of the leaf, and this one is the X scale. So let's reduce the X scale to 0.25. And you see they're starting to get closer, so let's reduce it again. And it's sort of debatable whether the hexagonal or cylindrical shape is better than the rectangular shape, because really they should be larger at the bottom than at the top. So the hexagonal shape does give you the nice needle shaped point. Obviously we need a lot more of them, but it also makes them narrower at the base, whereas the rectangular one gives you a completely straight shape. I'm just going to go with the rectangular, so we need to think about the scale and quantity of them now. So I think I'm going to go back to branch growth, and we're going to need to make these secondary branches a little bigger now, because they are the only branches holding those leaves. So there's the length, and we can now increase that. So let's go to 0.35, or even 0.5. So you can see what we've got there. And now we go back to the leaves, and we need to add quite a few more. So let's go up to 50, and they need to be somewhat bigger. So let's take them up to 0.25 and turn the X scale down to 0.025. Starting to look better. We can still see a bit too much of the branch itself. 50 is the most leaves we can have on our tree. So that's 50 per branch. But of course, what we can do is go back to branch splitting, and we can increase the number of them. So we've only got 15 of the tertiary branches. So let's try 20 and then maybe 25. You're just adding more branches at that third level. So I'm going to go up to leaves again, and I'm just going to turn off the leaves for a moment so that we can play around with the growth of our branches a little bit. So just bringing them back up somewhat. So you'll need to do this just to get the overall shape of your tree somewhere near how you want it. It doesn't matter too much, and we're not even going to see the base of some of these trees. And then I'll turn my leaves back on. And maybe we can increase the scale a little now. Go to 0.35. And you need to play around with it, but that's going to just about do for now. So having created your basic tree, we go back to geometry. We want to save that. So we'll call this pine 1. So we're now going to just say export preset. So once you've exported your preset, we can now finalize this one. Just press G, move it around somewhere, and then it should finalize. Now we can put the 3D cursor somewhere else and add another tree. Make sure limit export is switched off, otherwise it will only import a certain amount of the tree. Select pine 1, and initially we'll get an identical duplicate. But what we can now do without changing any of the settings is change the random seed. So you can now see in this case we've got a slightly bigger tree. We can go to another random seed, and each time it'll be a tree that's based off the same formula but with a slightly different shape. And I'll make one more tree, so it's a very easy and quick way to make variations on a theme. But make sure that you have moved your tree around so that it finalizes it. Didn't need to do that previously, but they seem to have made it stick a little more now. So we then just add another curve, add tree, load preset pine 1, and set the random seed to something else, and just move it around a little bit. So we've now got our three trees. At the moment, they're still curves, which can be useful. And what you'll also notice is that the leaves, in fact, are a mesh. We know that because of the options available up here. But the branches, we get a curve option available, which shows you that it's a curve, which means they're not the same object. So I'll select the branch, go to the menu options, say new, and we'll call this bark. And we'll just give this a very basic brown material for the moment and copy that to the viewport color. So I'll select the next one and select the bark material, and select the next one and do the same. Now we can create a basic material for the leaves. So again, new, and we'll call this needles. Just a basic dark green material for the moment. And a good reason for dragging colours over to the viewport colour is it makes it very quick to see which object has which material. So that's three basic pine trees. Obviously we haven't done very much with materials yet. So logically that's what we need to do next. So I'm going to add a sun lamp into this layer to help me see what I'm doing. And I'm going to give it a slight yellow color because that's what I have in the other one. And we'll set it to strength 3. We go to render now and zoom in our trees. And already, even though it's a very simple texture, that's not bad. I wouldn't say they are perfect by any means, but it's a pretty good representation of an evergreen tree. They probably need more pine needles on them, but for the tutorial, this will do fine. But we need to add a little bit of complexity, I think, to the materials, especially the needle material. So we'll select the bark to start with. So for the bark texture, really, I'm not going to go into any great detail, and I quite like that sort of red looking material, so we'll go with that. But we'll add in a bit of glossy, as most materials have some of that. Drop it in there, set it down to something like 0.015. So it's this that we're affecting. I'll zoom in on that. Roughness fairly high, and then maybe we'll add a texture, which is a noise texture. You notice I haven't unwrapped these. Add converter, which is a math node. Set that to multiply. Put the noise texture into one side, and then take that out into displacement. I'm just going to pause the rendering there, just because it's slowing things down. Set this up to 150 and the detail up to 16 should be fine. And then we'll have a look at what that renders. And you can see that's added a little bit of variation to the surface. And we could do that to color as well if we wanted to. And I think I'll just darken that color a little bit. And I think that will do fine for the bark. Maybe darker a little bit more. So now we need to do something for the needles. I quite like the color, but we need to do a little bit more with it than that. I'm going to pause the rendering again. So I'm going to add from the input an RGB node. And I'm going to just drag that color over to there. The reason will become clear in a moment. Then take the output of that into the color on my RGB node. The next thing I'm going to do is add a gamma node. Drop that into there. So gamma intensifies and darkens color. And we'll take that up to about 1.8. Now I'm going to add an add shader. Put that on this side of that diffuse. And then I'm going to add a translucent shader, which takes the output from that gamma node. So the translucent has got a darkened version of the color compared to the diffuse node, and that is the other side of the add shader. I'm also going to add a mix shader and a glossy shader. Set to my preferred method. Make sure it's full white and a roughness at about 0.125. And now if we let that render, so at the moment that's a bit too high, the glossy, and that's because we've got a factor of 0.5. So let's go for 0.01, and that's certainly a lot better. So we've got some brighter areas where the pine needle is reflecting the light better and darker areas. If you don't like these hard cut-off ends, then obviously you can go for the different shape of pine needles. As I said before, you can even use these square shapes and then add an alpha texture, and I've shown how to do that in the autumn path tutorial. But I'm fairly happy with this for the distance at which we're going to see these pine needles. They're perhaps a little bigger than I did previously. And now we can play with this and perhaps darken this color slightly, as I think pine needles are fairly dark in color. And that will do for now. For this tutorial, that's certainly fine. So these will actually do for the close-up pines that I had in the seed, but they won't do for the long distance views, because there's just too much geometry. So before we go any further, what I'm going to do is select the base, press Alt-C, and you see we get a convert menu, and convert them to mesh from curve. Do the same to the next one, Alt-C, mesh from curve, and the same to the last one, Alt-C, mesh from curve. Then I'm going to select the leaves for that tree, then the base, and just select join. You can do Control J, obviously. Select the tree, then the base, join, tree, then the base, and join. So we've now got three tree objects, and logically we should name them, but I'm not going to worry too much about that at the moment. So what we now need to do, in fact, is make an image based on these three trees. So I'm going to actually put them reasonable distance apart, because I want to have these trees in the scene one at a time. And I'm even going to rotate them on the Y 90 degrees so that we can have them in our camera view like that. I'm not even going to move the camera. I'm going to come over to here and I'm going to select under the render settings, under film, transparent background. So you can now see the background's gone black. If I turn this off, there is our background, but I've ticked transparent background. So the background, although it's contributing to the light on the tree, it's no longer rendering. Now what I do need to do is think about where the sun's coming from. And although its physical position doesn't matter that much, The sun will be shining, in terms of where I'm looking at the tree, from one side, but not completely down. I'm only moving the tree to help me think about where the light is shining on the tree. So if I look back at my tree again and render that, now I think I need to turn the brightness of that sun up a bit, and we'll go for a size of 0.15, which is obviously softer than the sun in the main scene, but I think that'll be fine. So that's quite a nice image of our fir tree, pine tree. So I need to render that out now to an image with a transparent background. It's important to say RGBA, which gives you the alpha channel. So let's press F12 and give that a render. And you can see here, because of this cross-hatching, this has got a transparent background. Now, if you wanted to, you could take images of this tree from several different angles and use those multiple different images in the next step. In reality, because these are going to be seen from some distance, that's not really necessary. It's good to have more than one tree, but it's not necessary to have lots of different angles on a given tree. So save as image, make sure it's RGBA. I would create a folder and call it something like Pine Alpha, and we'll call this Pine Tree Alpha 1. Then you can move that one out of the way, select your next pine tree, rotate on the Y90 just to get it positioned well. Scale it to nearly fill the image. You don't want to completely fill the image. And again, render that. And we can save that. And you do that for all three trees. I'll just do those two. Having done that, you've now created the basics of what you need. So something I forgot to say is, as well as setting this to transparent, to make sure you get a transparent background, and this to RGBA, you also need to set the color depth to 16 for it to work. If you don't do that, I mean, you'd think Blender would set this automatically, but it doesn't. If you don't do that, the transparent background again won't work. So you need to set both these things and then do your render. And then we can file save as image, and in this case, Pine Tree Alpha 2. We can then import images as planes. If you haven't got that option, go to User Preferences, start typing image, and make sure import images as planes is ticked. Under mesh, images as planes, go to your folder, select the image you want to use. Make sure that diffuse and transparent is selected. By default, it's diffuse. If you don't do that, it's just a few extra steps to do later. Import images as planes, and you should get a set of nodes created for you. I'll explain the function in a moment. They're not laid out terribly well, but it'll do. So if I now look down at my object, I'll turn off transparent, I'll set it back to a color depth of 8, and we'll turn off RGBA. We don't need any of those things, and we'll go to render view. And you can now see that we've got an image of our tree. If I add a sun into this scene, just to illuminate it a little better, because we're looking down on this plane, we can see that looks like a pretty good tree. Of course, it's just a flat plane. So this is working in a fairly simple way. There's our material output, and we've got a mix shader here. This is our diffuse texture, which is our tree. If I take this output directly to the surface, you can see there is the tree, but there's a black background. But there's actually some more information than that. If I take the alpha output from this image texture to the diffuse, you can see we've got white wherever there's tree and black for everywhere else. So that's the alpha channel that we created. I actually take that in to the control input on this mix shader. The color output goes to the input of the diffuse, and then the output of the mix shader goes to the material. So effectively, where it's black, we're showing the transparent. Where it isn't black, where it's white, we're showing the image. It's as simple as that. So all we now need to do is make it a bit more 3D. For this one, it's important that you're in texture or material mode. Material is probably easier. I'm going to rotate this just because it's easy to manipulate that way. So I'm going to rotate on the Z 90 and then rotate on the X 90. I'm now going to look from the front. I'm going to get rid of that window. I don't need it at the moment. Go into edit mode, and I'm just going to pull this up such that the base of my tree, or the image of my tree, is just starting, that this little origin dot is just above that. So in edit mode, because it's just four vertices, by the way, Shift D, you can see I can move that one around, and then I'm going to rotate on the Z. I could just rotate 90 degrees, and that for the majority of cases will be fine. I'm going to rotate 45 degrees because I'm going to do another one. Now, the only thing to be aware of, you can see this is why I'm looking in material mode so that I can see through it. You need to make sure that the tree aligns at least reasonably well. It doesn't have to be perfect. So I'm just going to move that plane around a little bit. Then Shift D, just click, and then rotate Z 90. which is effectively 45 and 45. So we've now got branches coming out everywhere. Now, if you want to, you can, of course, rotate Z 180 to completely swap round, effectively, those branches on the tree. And 45 isn't required either. It can be any angle. You've just got to be a bit careful about how this all aligns. And this is what I was saying about you could use images taken from different angles if you really wanted to make it a higher quality image. But effectively, that is our tree there. So this is a total of 12 vertices for what, at a reasonable distance, looks like a pretty good tree. So you can see here, we've got a pretty good representation of the tree. But one thing we will need to do is add some variation in the trees. There you can see where the sun's shining on it. So to do that, we just need to add a few more nodes. I'm going to add an input, which is an object info node. The output we want to use is this random output, which basically gives you a different random number between 0 and 1 for each object that you create with this material. I'm going to add color mix node, and I'm going to drop it into there so that the texture goes into one side and there's a color on the other. I'm going to set this to darken. And then I'm going to set this color to a fairly dark blue color. And finally, take the random and put that into the control input. So that will switch between the original material and the material mixed with this blue color. So let's just have a look at that. And basically, if I make some duplicates of this with Shift D, I've made 3 copies. Each object created will have a slightly different mix value. You may just be able to see that this tree is quite a bit more yellow than this tree. What we may want to do is add a little bit of translucence to this one as well, but not reflection, because that's not going to work properly. So we can add a mix shader here. I'm using a mix shader rather than an add shader, so I can control it better. Add translucent shader, probably a gamma node under the color options. Take that up a little bit. And then feed that into the other side of the mix shader. So if we go all the way to that side, we're just seeing the translucent color. I think we will change that to an add shader. So that just gives a little bit of extra light, but you've got to be careful with that. You may be able to see the flat planes more obviously. Whereas if I take this straight in, and all this is doing really is just adding a little bit of extra light in there. So it's lightening up these darker areas, which is fine. So we can close the material window now. And the last thing that I want to do is I'm going to scale on the Z. I'm going to scale this one down so it's a squat tree, and scale on the Z this one up so it's a tall, thin tree. It's really just the aspect ratio of them that matters, not so much the overall size, because that's set by the particle system. I'm then going to select each of the trees and control G, and we'll call this the trees. So that's created a group called the trees. Can I go back to our main scene, and we'll go to solid view, look through the camera, and we're ready to start our particle system. So before we do that, let's get an idea of where we want the particles. Alternatively, we can work out where we don't want them. So we go into wireframe in edit mode, and we can start selecting some vertices. So we probably want it to climb the hills. We want it all down here, and perhaps around here, potentially anyway. And bear in mind, these trees may grow into the scene, as it were, so you don't want to completely stop outside the camera. But everything back here, of course, is out of view of the camera, so there's absolutely no point in any of these vertices having trees on them unless they are somewhat near the camera view. So we'll go with that for the moment, and we'll say plus and assign. So that's hopefully, if I deselect everything and then say select, that's assigned a vertex group that we can use for the particle system. So we now go to particles, say new, and change it to a hair particle system. The whole system's slowing down at the moment because we've got so many vertices, obviously, here. If I come over here and switch off the visibility of the subdivision surface, that'll make it a lot more manageable. I'm going to say use modifier stack, though, so that the tree particle system is aware of the extra vertices and the lumps and bumps that we've added. Before we go any further, I'm going to go round to vertex groups and say group here. I'm going to change this under render to group, and then we're going to select the trees. We're going to say rotation and pick random. Now, it's quite an interesting pattern, but it's not what we're looking for. They're all lying down at the moment. So we come over to our tree group, select all the trees, just say R for rotation, Y for the Y axis, and 90, and press return. Come back to here, and they're either the right way up, in fact, I think they're upside down. So if we now rotate Y 180, They're now, roughly speaking, the right way up. However, the trees are all pointing at strange angles. So what we need to do is say advanced, click that for rotation, and the velocity is global Z. So they'll all point upwards, although they're actually pointing down again. So in fact, we were probably right the first time. So we just rotate Y 180 again, and that's all good. Now, what we will need to do is add a little bit of variation in that because they're all pointing exactly vertically right now. So we can add a little bit of random, but not too much. Trees tend to be reasonably upright. Phase put up to maximum and randomness up to maximum. Then we need to add some randomness to the size. Not too much, but some. And we'll probably need to play with the absolute size of the trees as well. But let's see what that looks like. So we need to bring another layer into the scene so that we can see what's going on. So they're probably a bit too small at the moment, possibly too many of them. So let's reduce the number to 500. But increase the size to 0.1. Now right now the area we cleared for the road is completely covered in them. So I think 0.075, and we need to select that sun, I think, and let's make that a little less harsh in terms of the hardness of the shadows. But you can see we're starting now to get something that resembles the trees. Maybe they are a little big actually. So this is one of those things you need to do. You need to play around. We'll go for 0.065 on the size with the settings. Now actually I want them rather more dense here. So what we can do is if we go to weight paint, you can see at the moment it's either red or blue. Blue meaning no selection and red meaning complete selection. But what I can do is select up here and say subtract, and I can start to reduce the density of the trees up here. I'm just left clicking now. So on the slopes, the trees are less dense, which means there's more trees for down here, of course. And it also means I can increase the overall density without it completely foresting the side of the mountain. I want a few trees up there, but obviously I don't want too many, as they don't seem to grow particularly dense up the side of a mountain. And we can also select the blur brush, just so that we've got a little bit of easing, as it were, in how the trees work. So the next thing to note is that we've got an area which we've reserved for the road. Now there's not that many vertices, which may prove a problem, but we'll see how we go. We go back to weight paint, and this time we'll go to subtract. And maybe we'll decrease the radius a bit, but put the strength right up. So I'm going to look down on it now. It's hard to see probably, but basically this area here is where the road is. So obviously we don't want trees growing on the road. Now we can do this. What we may find, if I go back into edit mode, is the easier thing to do, if I now select the road area, is actually to increase the number of base vertices where the road is. And of course we've probably got our mountains affecting this as well. Select that one and maybe that one, and then press W and subdivide. So we've got more vertices to play with there. Scale Z0 with proportional editing on, scale Z but not too big, 0. And now we can go to our vertex group and we can just say remove. And we may need to play with our seed a little bit just to get the particle system to notice. And you can see that's now cleared the trees from the road. I've just increased the brightness of the background just to so that we can see what's going on a little better. So you can now see we've got a cleared area that we're going to put the road on, and we've got trees growing all over here. Obviously you can spend a bit more time and make your trees more unique. Perhaps we can have a little bit more on the random size. We can even decrease the number of the trees, 0.055, but increase the number to 650 perhaps. So that makes them fairly dense down here, and then they get less dense as you go up the mountain. Now one of the issues that I noticed was obviously that at the trees that were closest to the camera didn't really look so good, because this is really a cheat way of creating trees. They're only really useful for the distance. I'm just sneaking the size up a little bit there. But what we want is some nice high resolution trees for close up. Now at this point, I'm going to switch to CPU render mode, because otherwise I'm probably going to get crashes. So to do that, I click here and go to CPU render. If you don't have that option available, then your card is probably not compatible with GPU render anyway. But that just means that it's going to render more slowly. So I'm going to set the render samples to 10. So if I now go back to this layer, we've got our three trees. So I'm going to bring them somewhere near each other. And the idea is that they're going to be relatively close to the camera. So I'm going to leave them in the layer that they're in, but you can see they're much too big at the moment. I'm going to delete this extra sun down here because it'll cause problems. And then we'll put them something like that. If I bring up the layer with my camera, just take these extra planes away. So there's my camera. And here's my close-up trees. It doesn't really matter whether they're embedded in the ground or not, because you're not going to see that part of them. The idea is just to give a bit of close-up fill that also helps to reinforce the idea that there are real trees in the scene and that they're actually all high resolution trees when of course they aren't. It also helps to frame the scene a little bit. And one of the little tricks of digital art is that there's always an element of cheating is perhaps not the right word, but understanding where detail is important and where it is less important. So I'm actually going to put this tree over here. I'm just moving it around on the Y just to pull it in and out. So this scene's turning out very slightly differently to the other one, but that's okay. So let's have a render of that. I think we need to just make sure we're rendering with the other layers on as well, just so that we can see it in context and get more light in the scene. And one of the challenges with this scene is that it is quite a dark scene, and dark scenes are always extra difficult to do, at least in Blender and probably in other suites as well, because obviously the less light there is, the less information there is to play with. Very often what you'll do is you'll render actually a much brighter scene and then dim it down in various different ways. This is, as I say, still quite a dark scene, and what I'll typically do once this is rendered is I'll actually play with the gamma in the scene and things like that to brighten the shadows up, because you can see there's a lot of dark shadows here. But even so, you can see this is beginning to work. These high resolution trees now tie into the scene and help to give that impression that all of these trees are high resolution trees, which of course they aren't. We've got a couple of trees in the water down here, but I'm not going to worry too much about those. They probably won't be visible anyway. And we've got an area for the road. So I think that's gone on long enough. We've got one more part of the tutorial to do, and that will be quickly creating the road and a little car with some headlights, which I thought was quite important to the story of the scene. But also, the most important part will be the volumetrics, which gives that mist layer in the scene. So I hope you found that useful. If you did, let me know. If you enjoy these tutorials, don't forget to click like and subscribe, and I'll see you in the next one. Thanks a lot.